Welcome to the show, everybody. It's great to be back live here. Thanks for being here on the show tonight, everyone, for the first episode of season four here at Sasquatch NHL. Kraken about to embark upon their fourth campaign as a franchise, and the regular season is upon us, you guys. We've got just 6 days now. October 8th is opening day at Climate Pledge Arena. That's next Tuesday. And we're going to move fast tonight because it's late already, and we're going to record about half of this live and then about half of it offline. And Rick is joining me tonight. Rick Judd in the Zoom room. What's up, Rick? How are you doing? How was your summer? How was your night? Ty says he can't hear Rick, so let's double check something real quick here. Preseason streams, it always happens. Let's just double check.
Yep. How does it sound now that I just gave my whole summer when no one...
The whole summer update. We're going to definitely edit this out. This is why we do preseason streams too, because, you know, it's just, that's how it goes, right? So
we'll see what
Ty says. He says, there we go. So we fixed it. Our first victory of the preseason. So let's start over again. Sorry about that. And thanks for the patience in the chat. Rick, tell us about your evening tonight.
It was everything we wanted to see that we hadn't yet seen of piling goals on. We'll get into a bunch of it, but was really happy watching the game tonight.
Rick actually had to update his computer prior to going live tonight. I had to do the same. I was prepared, but I guess maybe not fully prepared. But thanks for being here, everybody in the chat. Everybody helping out. And it was a great night. 6 goals from the Kraken, and that's going to be the emphasis that we talk about throughout the evening here. And also, as we go offline, we're going to record a little bit offline as well. So thanks for tuning in, everybody. This episode, we're going to go quickly through the recap of the 6th and final preseason game tonight. And like I said, transition a little bit into a season preview of the Kraken and Pacific Division as we head into season 4. Rick, let's break everything down for just a little bit. Maybe kind of your first impressions of the preseason overall as we get going here on the live stream tonight.
I would say this preseason is definitely, we're starting to see his system and really what makes his success click within this Coachella Valley and Seattle Kraken system. Because to me, this preseason was about how well the young kids showed up. Having guys like Winterton be still in camp. Shane Wright has had a great camp. Chalet found the net. Like all these guys that have been able to either at Coachella work under Bielsma or be a part of that fresh young core system that has gotten to work during rookie camps or other places where they'll get to see him. That is really what's making him flourish as a coach now. And this was really our only game this preseason that has featured what the roster is going to look like. It had been really packed with a lot of those young kids that we all knew weren't going to make camp. They were going to get reassigned back down to minors. They were going to get put on waivers to go to Coachella Valley. This was the first time this was conceivably what our roster is going to look like next week. And it was really good to see them play how they did tonight. But I would say for me, the preseason was really, this is what our future in 2, 3, 4, 5 years is going to look like as this franchise.
For sure. And it kind of feels like we're seeing the future start to unfold right in front of us here as we get into the fourth season for the Kraken. Got a few comments here. We're going to take comments throughout the show. Great to have everybody. Beneath the Waves and Ty and Carol. Ty says a tad quiet, so we adjusted it. And producer Ty was reporting there for us. We got Beneath the Waves. And like I said, Carol's Dark Sarcasm says, hooray! So a big win for the Kraken to close out the preseason. And like I said, we've got a lot to talk about tonight. And I'm really excited about the trajectory of the Kraken through the preseason. I know some of the games were not so pretty to watch. That's to be expected, right? And you've got a lot of the younger prospects in. But we're seeing Shane Wright really kind of establish himself playing a strong game, two-way game. He's finding a way offensively, puck retrievals. He's keeping plays alive. I really think that's the highlight for me. So excited to talk about that a little bit. Let's talk just a little bit about the Oilers and the Kraken coming into tonight. Maybe the setup just a little bit, Rick. And the Oilers, they went all the way to the Stanley Cup last season, lost to the Florida Panthers in 7 games, almost pulled off the reverse sweep. Connor McDavid put them on his shoulders, and they just fell short. Any thoughts about the Oilers coming into this season?
I mean, as long as they have the two-headed like monster of Draisaitl and McDavid up front, they're always going to be a force to be reckoned with. Obviously, 2 years ago, Nugent Hopkins was a 100-point caliber player. Did not have that last year, but you had Zach Hyman fill in for that and be a 50-goal scorer. So it feels like they lead with the two, and then they always somehow find the supporting cast that usually with a team that has such dominant stars like a McDavid and Draisaitl, it's really hard to fill your third and fourth line with really depth that the Kraken have really made their calling card over the last three seasons, being able to score from all four lines. The way that you have a 100-point score on your team is they are on the ice a lot and they are scoring almost every shift. And that's kind of how the Oilers have been. Like, they do have some pretty established and generational talent, but you beat them when McDavid and Draisaitl are not on the ice. And that's how we've beat them before. And then we've also seen them beat us because we let McDavid be McDavid on the ice while he's there.
Well, and surprisingly tonight, you know, the Kraken went shorthanded a little more than I would have liked, especially against the Oilers, but they weren't really able to break through on the power play. And the Kraken, you know, their special team's going to be in focus throughout the season here, trying to shift their culture a little bit. We've got the new coach, Dan Bosma, like you alluded to just a minute ago. But they want to play a fast game, a quick game, find goal scoring wherever you can, crash the net. Some of these little tweaks in the Kraken system we can talk a little bit more in depth about later, but maybe just your quick thoughts on, you know, the Kraken, what they're trying to do to get the puck funneled to the net and enter the zone quickly this season.
It's different because that is not the way Haskell played hockey. So it is really exciting to see them play this fast and to really aggressively enter the zone, because that is never been the calling card for a Dave Haxtell team. And it was always one of those pieces that really left you frustrated with some losses in these last few years, was they would take their time and they would build up the scoring chance looking for the specific lane that they had drawn up on paper that refused to show itself. And rather than adapt or try something else or get creative, they would just keep moving the puck around, trying to open up the lane. It would usually end in a turnover, and then you'd go the other way and you'd get beat on the transition. So moving fast, crashing the net it boggles my mind that that is not an offensive mindset for every single shift, for every single team. You need people in front of the net, and it is proven that as long as you put a body in front of that goalie and you have people there for the rebound, you're going to score. Tanev's whole point, Schwartz's whole point, the whole reason why they get the points they do is they are right there in front of the net to get the tip-ins and to get those rebounds. And if we do that a lot more this season and crash that net, I think we're going to have a lot better of a scoring offense than we had last year.
Yeah, that urgency lacked at times. You know, maybe they stuck to the pattern and routine a little bit too long last season and some of the seasons before that. But Ty is excited, says, it's disco time. I'm running a fever. Let's go, boys. And he says, who is Hack? And so, you know, respect out to Hackstall, but it's time to turn that page. And we were all kind of ready for something different. And I think the team has embraced that. The front office definitely signaled that through the offseason. I think we might have a Kraken captain announced soon. We'll see. We're going to talk about that in the last half of this broadcast. So, like I said, make sure you tune in for the full episode. Give Rick a follow over on Twitter or X if you don't already. Always insightful, always great to have here on the show. Going to have the same cast of characters throughout the season, but like I said, going to collaborate a little bit more with Rick throughout the season. I'm really looking forward to that. Let's look at the roster real quick, Rick, and then we're going to break down the goals, which ended up being a little bit more than I thought after the first period was just a dry spell, but we're going to talk about the game. Here's the roster. We had Brandon Tanev had to shift up to the top line because Jared McCann was out. Matty Beniers, Brandon Tanev, Vince Dunn, Philip Grubauer starting in net. Maybe just some of your thoughts on the roster real quick. Winterton was in for that. Maybe last look here in the preseason before they finalize things.
Like I said, I think this is the first time this preseason, which is pretty standard for preseason, you play a lot of your whole organization and you play a lot of those minors and the guys that you know aren't going to be playing in the NHL this season. But this is the first time we really saw what the NHL Seattle Kraken are going to look like. Obviously, with 24 guys still in camp, there's a move that needs to be made or two. We are also a little over $2 million over the cap right now. I liked the way the roster looked. This is exactly what we want a Kraken roster to look like. That is got it's the Kraken version of a top six, which I mean, that's been since the franchise started is the argument of, do we have really a true top line? And what does our top six look like compared to the rest of the league? But I think as you spread out the talent, this is going to be four offensive lines that can score at any time. And you could put a third or fourth line. If we keep that third line of Tolvanen, Gord, and Bjorkstrand together this year, that's a third line that would be successful against some top lines. Like we saw that playoff series in season two, where our third line outplayed the top line of that Colorado Avalanche.
So maybe depth is back in the deep is kind of what you're saying. I think that, you know, that's going to be the theme if they're going to have success. And that's obviously how you have to do, have to approach, you know, your offense and mm-hmm. adding to your goal totals. So you got to score goals to win games. It didn't happen last year. I thought the defense and goaltending last year was fine. I have no complaints there. It was just, we didn't score enough goals. And that's a huge theme coming into this season. Ty says, do we get a captain on Tuesday? And like I said, we are going to talk about this, but we're going to wait just a little bit because I don't want to dive into that until the back half of this stream. But Rick, I know you've got some thoughts on it, but let's hold off on that. Just a little bit of a tease, I understand. But let's go into the game recap just a little bit here. Going to get your take, Rick. We're going to talk about the goals, all six of them from the Kraken. Quick rundown. Quick recap, and then we're going to get into the season preview for the Kraken a little bit deeper. Talk about that depth, like Rick just brought up. Grubauer in net for the Kraken, like we talked about. Rodrigue for Edmonton, might not be saying that right. It's tough in the preseason. A lot of names you're not familiar with, right?
Yeah, so, tons.
Yeah.
Especially in hockey.
Kraken, like I said, without Jared McCann. Oilers taking a couple penalties early, putting the Kraken on the power play. They don't break through on those, but some good movement, and that's going to be a theme throughout the season, right, Rick? Movement on the power play.
Yeah, and that's really what I want to see. There were flashes last year on the power play where you'd get that cross-ice movement and you'd find the extra forward, if you will, on the power play who takes that defensive spot out on the wing, and you would see them trying to force the play over there for a shot. And it just wasn't happening. And so having a lot of puck movement and a lot of good quality, quick pace of play on that power play is going to be how we turn that unit, both of them, both the PP1 and PP2, those are going to be successful the faster you play when you have that man advantage.
Yeah, maybe being a little bit less predictable. And even if you are predictable, if you're moving fast, it's hard to anticipate and keep up with it. So we'll see how that evolves over the first few weeks of the season. We get through the first period. Bjorki, right at the end of that period, buzzes a shot just past the net. Close call, but it's 0-0 through 20 minutes. Shots are 8-7 in favor of Edmonton. Pretty even there. We go to the second period, and we've got a waterfall of goals.
Yes.
Let me move the graphics around so we can see everybody that scored. But Brandon Tanev opens things up, making it 1-0. Kind of flashed through the slot there and tipped it in. If you saw that one, give us a quick description of that, Rick.
Yeah, I kind of mentioned it a little earlier, but that's the Tanev special. High energy, crash the net, and be there when there's a shot that you can either tip in or take a rebound. And I think that was year two that Tanev had his career highs in shots and goals and assists. And he is the type of player you want in that bottom six group that is just going to be 110% all the time. That's really what he specialized in. And I'm happy to have seen him finding that groove now and not have to wait and try and collect it, find it, get in the groove as the regular season starts.
For sure. And if you've got a Brandon Tanev playing good hockey, that is good all around. If you need to move someone, not saying they are going to, but he's been one of the names that's been rumored here and there, and they will probably have to make a move at some point. So the better hockey he plays, the better return you're going to get. So it's just good for everybody all around, and love to see Tanev have success in this lineup, especially playing up on the top line. Ty quickly says, can we buzz about Sheen a bit? We should, because I think he scores the next goal. He's on the roster, no question. Is he eligible for the Calder? Pretty sure he is. I don't think he is because he went over the six games last year. So we can double check on that. But that second goal, just moments later, Rick, Shane breaks through, finishes that spinning backhand right in front of the net there from Oliver Bjorkstrand. Crazy goal.
That is probably not something many fans have seen from Shane Wright at this point, because that is Shane at his high confidence, knowing his skill and playing how he wants to play and how he knows he can as a top of the first round draft pick, highlight player of his draft class that we have yet to really see outside of when he was demolishing competition at the junior level. That is the special Shane Wright that could have gone first overall, that we all went nuts over, that we got him at fourth overall. That's the type of hockey he was playing in the few games he played up at the NHL last year. And that is what needs to be what we're all excited for him. So he won't be Calder eligible, but I feel like that's going to be a benefit to him, because one, that's pressure that's not going to be there. And two, we don't have to worry about trying to push a narrative or ice time to try and get him to win that. It's just, you are ready to play hockey. You are a young skater. You are talented. You have, sky is the limit for you. Go do it. You don't have any like trophy chasing or anything like that. Like, there was a lot of pressure on Matty Berniers his first season because everyone was expecting him to be a Calder favorite, and he did, and he won, which is great. But that's a lot of pressure for a young kid that Shane's not going to have this first season.
So here we go. Moving forward now, Oilers push back a little bit on the power play. Just past the midway point, they find the back of the net. Leon Draisaitl in his office puts one past Grubauer there, so they cut the lead to one, and they tie it up. Dermott kind of left all alone in front of the net. Defense a little lacking there. I mean, maybe your thoughts on that one.
That is tough, and it's something we see too often with this club. And oddly, it's this weird phenomenon, but it happens a ton when Grubauer is in net. He can't catch any breaks. He experiences a rebound, a second or third chance goal, it feels like almost every time he plays. And it's inexplicable. There's like no real way to explain it. Like, it is just this weird phenomenon that happens. Maybe it's down to he could absorb and catch a shot rather than just going for a block or save or to block and push it out. Who knows? Mm-hmm. It seems to happen a ton. And those are goals that just, it's real hard. But for me, I put that more on the defense, because there's a lot of positioning that could have been better in that crease area and in that, like, that spot right in front of the net. You can't leave people open. You can't let them harass the goalie, because it's going to be bad for your defense every time.
Yeah, I just kind of snuck through there. They lost coverage just a little bit. The rebound, you know, like you said, maybe not handled as best as it could be. And that's that. So it's a tie game at that point, 2-2. Ty did weigh in, said, to be eligible for the Calder, a player cannot have played more than 25 games in any single preceding season, nor in six or more games in each of any two preceding seasons. So there's the actual rule. Thanks for looking it up, Ty. And that, unfortunately, Mr. Shane Wright, ineligible for the Calder, but I think we're okay with that here. We'll keep moving here. Floodgates open a little bit through the second period. Brandon Montour, Monty with a big blast, reclaims the lead for the Kraken. And there's that speed and that, that power from Montour.
Yeah, that is what you go and sign a top of the free agent class defender for. Yes, he was part of why Dermott was open on the previous goal, either that one or the Draisaitl goal, but there was something. He was on the ice out of position a bit for one of the Edmonton goals, but he makes up for it. He is a stronger and bigger Vince Dunn of an offensive minded defender. And we need some of that. While the AAV and the actual amount of money might be a little high, and maybe the years are a bit, but that's what you go after a player like that for, and that's what you pay big dollars for, is to have somebody like that put shots like that on net when you need it.
Yeah, I feel like Montour is a little more decisive than Vince Dunn at times, and he just has a little different presence, but great puck mover, very similar in that realm, and you know, he can really deal the puck around up top on the power play. So I'm looking forward to that. And that big shot broke through there. reclaiming the lead for the Kraken. Shane Wright again on the board with a slick little wrister there, making it 4-2. Kraken open up a 2-goal lead at the end of the second period. And you love to see Shane Wright on the board again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And like I said, he's one of the highlights of this preseason. Even before the 2-goal game tonight, he was a major highlight of the system working and building up these young skaters, and now getting to play with Bielsma at the NHL level, where he's seen them play down in the AHL and seen them grow. This is what's going to happen. We're going to see some of these kids really start to come into their own, and they're going to fit in and slot in very well, to the point of like when John Hayden came up that first year he was with us, I think that was year two, came in, filled the space, did well. Jesper Froden filled in, came in, filled the space well. We're going to be able to do that more this year, especially with a lot of that cast and crew from Coachella returning, and then knowing and being able to jump up to this next level, knowing how we're playing hockey. That's what you want out of a system, is you want to be able to have that consistency at both levels so that you can plug and play anyone and not just rely on that one guy who might be waiver exempt, so you can move him up and down as much as you want, who can play at the NHL, but really is probably more of an AHL player, like a Andrew Podorowski, for instance, last year. That was one of you move him back and forth because he can slot in, but he's really down in the AHL level. We're going to be able to freely move some of these young kids, and they're going to feel comfortable.
Yeah, that continuity from the AHL up to the NHL, the systems that are in place, finding players that are able to be shifted around and adaptable. That's really key to the way the Kraken want to play, I think. Ty also says, I have to say I was excited to see the Oilers tie it up. Those swings in the momentum are huge on the ice. I was elated to see them continue to push and stack on four more new tides. And, you know, last year, sometimes they got away from their resiliency at times. Things weren't going great. But, you know, see a little glimpse of that in the preseason. Hopefully they can carry that forward into the regular season. Let's go to the third period real quick here as they extend their lead a little bit further, making it 6-2 with the Jaden Schwartz goal and William Borgen on the tally sheet as well. So it's always good to see buzz cut Borgie with a goal.
Yeah.
Right.
Rocking the new do. he's been our sneaky blue liner. I feel like he's our hidden secret. He was the pick from Buffalo when there was maybe some other names people wanted out of Buffalo during that expansion draft at the beginning. And he was the long-term project. He barely played that first year, had a lot of press booth time as he was healthy scratched. But it worked because he's come into his own. He's a solid second, third pairing defender that has a real good place on this roster. Well deserved his extension. And I think it's just a matter now of who his blue line partner is going to be as we fit those pairings together. I think we all know that he's kind of a menace defensively, and he isn't afraid to hit anyone. But it is always nice to see him get involved in that offense.
Definitely. And, you know, so the Kraken finish off preseason with a victory 6-2. It was a great night overall in the deep, the last preseason game at home. And they'll open up regular season on Tuesday against the St. Louis Blues. Let's look at the game stats and maybe just anything that pops out to the front of your mind here, Rick, as we break this down a little bit further, looking at the numbers.
Yeah. Faceoffs are always a big thing for me. The Kraken have only ever had one center finish above a 50% on their faceoff wins that took a primary role in faceoffs, and that was Pierre-Edouard Belmar last year. And even he was a little less than the other three centers, but he finished above 50% for the first time as a featured center for the Kraken. That's what Chandler Stevenson is supposed to be for us. Maybe not quite to the extent of how significant Belmar's face-off capabilities were. But Chandler Stevenson hasn't had a below 50% face-off season since 2019. But I'm really looking forward to seeing how a veteran presence from the face-off dot, like Belmar was last year, is going to help the rest of those forwards.
Yeah, I can't wait to see just the way the full complement comes together. I think that having more experienced guys like Stevenson, you know, throughout the roster with Maddie and Shane starting to develop and see, you know, how they can kind of blend together across the lines and see what they can put together. It's going to be really interesting to me. I know that a lot of people didn't love the Stevenson contract. I'm kind of included in that camp, but sometimes it's tough up here in Seattle to get guys to sign the dotted line and get into this market and buy in. And sometimes you've got to pay a little bit more. So that's just, you know, market prices at times, and we'll see what happens.
It's going to be a great contract for the first 3 years, maybe 4 years. Yeah. At that point, then that's where it's going to start looking, depending on how high the cap goes and how wear and tear happens. But I think for the initial part, I think we're going to see a lot of early benefit to that contract.
Absolutely. And they just announced the preliminary cap bump next year is going to be about $4.5 million to around 92.5. So it's good to see the cap going up. That means there's more revenue coming into the league. And I think that's good overall. Ty pointed out blocked shots, 21 blocked shots for the Kraken. Is this going to be a new area that we're seeing from the Kraken defensively?
That sure would be nice. I mean, you saw later-ish in the game where Tanev took one off like the high skate, like right at like the ankle area. And those smart, those hurt. Ty plays hockey. He knows. But you've got to have
plays
defense.
Hockey.
I'll let you be that air quote.
He's going to come over here and beat me up.
Block shots, you got to have them sometimes. You can't just let lanes open up, especially against a team like the Oilers, who have guys that can shoot from pretty much everywhere. But it looked like Tanev was able to finish out the game. It was just kind of one of those, like, it smarts for a few minutes, and by the time his next shift is up, he still finished with 20 shifts. I think it happened right around the like 15 to like 16 shifts in of when that stop was, or the block. So when something like that happens, you get kind of concerned of what's that injury going to look like. Particularly, bigger conversation to be had, but particularly with Tanev, you don't want to see him right now get hurt in any way. I think calling out those block shots is good, especially with that much of a discrepancy between 21 block shots for the Kraken to 12 for the Oilers, with not that much of a bigger difference in overall shots.
Good metrics overall tonight, I felt like. And, you know, it wasn't like the Oilers iced a Bush League roster or anything. They had a lot of their regulars out tonight. So, and it is still preseason. Nothing can be determined. And I don't even like to make any evaluations till, you know, a couple weeks into the season at all. But Ty said, Stevie will shine come playoffs. He's talking Chandler Stevenson there. Poison experience. So a great piece to have for a playoff run. Got to get there first, of course. And then he says, bro, I was on the ice today. I'll catch you up. Don't worry. I thought he was going to say, I'll catch you. Don't worry. And then I saw the catch you up. So, okay. Who's going to yeet more fish this year, Grubauer or J-Dak? I'm going to just hedge and say Joey Decord. I think he might end up getting more starts, but who knows? Grubauer can get streaky and hot. Yep. And like you said, Rick, it might depend on who ends up being the hot hand, but the change in style with Bylsma versus Hakstol, it may be more of an even split.
Yeah, I will agree with you that I think Decord will probably yeet more fish. Just in the last few years, what we've seen from both of them, their bodies of work, Decord tends to have a better spot game than Grubauer does.
All right, so a great finish for the Kraken overall tonight. 6-2, they take their final preseason game of the 2024-2025 preseason, and we're ready for October 8th. Rick, let's talk about a little bit of maybe just some fun stuff real quick. We're going to do a little bit of over-under predictions, and I prepped a few of these for you before we started the stream and the episode today, but just kind of wanted to get your take. I tried to find a good line, play odds maker just a little bit. Okay, so let's start with Matty Beniers. The over-under for him I set at 23 goals. Do you think he's going to score more than that or less than that? What are you looking for?
I think that's a great line. The next time we do these, we should bring the Kraken Pod guys in, because I know that they've got the DraftKings sponsor, so they're really up on the number lines and stuff. But I think 23 is a great number. I think he goes over. I think the quote-unquote sophomore slump, I think, is done. I think he worked through the adversity of having a season where he didn't live up to his own expectations, the fans' expectations, the organization's. Having that down year, I think, really builds that character you need from a player. It sounds like he's bulking up a little bit. He just got a ton of money. Like, he's going to be playing a little bit different. He's not the young, touted prospect coming off a Calder Cup win anymore. He's now like an established hockey player. And I think 23 is well within his reach. I think he lands somewhere slightly over. I don't think he's going to eclipse 30, but I could definitely see him in that 25. I'm saying 25, so I'll go over.
The key for me is just, you alluded to it there, just the fact that he's kind of bulked up. His training through the offseason is going to be a huge factor, I think, for him to hit that next level. Growing up, I watched Patrick Marleau, and, you know, he was not the biggest, strongest guy in his first couple of years, but he had that work ethic, that dedication to training, and he got stronger and bigger and really hard to move off the puck mm-hmm. as he evolved as a player for the San Jose Sharks. I know he's a completely different player than Matty Beniers, but you can always take those lessons from yeah. some of the people that came before you. I think I agree with you. Matty's going to hit over 23. It is going to be under 30. But regardless, I like the way Matty is kind of stepping up. You know, he's got that contract now under his belt. He's willing mm-hmm. to do the hard work in the offseason. It seems like that's all good. You know, if he had showed up and, you know, if Ron Francis or Dan Bylsma had said, well, you know, we're going to have a little bit of work to do here in the preseason, maybe the conditioning, or, you know, sometimes they'll hint at that, but that was not the case. Matty was ready to go as yep. he hit camp, and I think it's going to propel him here into his third season. Let's get to another one. This is going to be a tricky one. Andre Burakovsky, he's struggled to stay healthy. The over-under for him, 41 games. Can he play for the Kraken this season?
I want that number to be a yes. Like, I want it to be an over so bad. Burakovsky's, he's a total team ice changer when he's on the ice. Like, he, when he's healthy and he's feeling it, he plays and just makes everyone else around him better. But I don't think he's played more than 50 games in his 2 years so far with the Kraken. And even just through preseason so far, we've seen some extra days of not skating in practice. I hate to do it, but I think I'm taking the under. I think there are ailments that just are going to compound themselves onto more and more. And I don't think he plays half a season.
So the last two seasons, 49 games last season, year prior, 49 games as well. So has kind of a 40, 50 game range, it looks like, mm-hmm. through, you know, you go back 5, 6, 7 years. He did play 80 games in 2021, 2022 with Colorado. So we'll see. I think I'm with you, unfortunately. It's disappointing the yeah. way it's gone here in Seattle. He can't seem to catch a break as far as health goes. Hoping for the best, but if I have to hedge and I have to be a betting man, I'm going to have to go with the under on that yeah. as well. So we'll see. Hoping for the best. And he could really propel the Kraken in their goal-scoring department if he can stay healthy
yes.
for more than those 41 games. So that could be mm-hmm. a huge factor if the Kraken are going to add to their goal totals, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Like I said, he makes everyone else on the ice better. I've seen him play healthy, feeling it, vibing, and really on a heater, if you will. He just moves slick on the ice. He has puck vision when he's feeling it. But I've also seen the flip side of him coming back from an injury, not playing for a few weeks, and having the puck be at his feet, and he's looking around trying to find where the puck is because he can't see it, and he's just not feeling it. And I've seen both versions of him, and it is a total drastic difference on how he plays, which is not really what you want in one of your big free agent signings as a franchise, especially coming off where he did play pretty well for the Avalanche. And even in the season before he signed with Seattle, he missed games at the end of the season because of, I think, an elbow or a wrist or something, came back in the playoffs to really come in clutch for the Avalanche to help get them toward a Stanley Cup. But even then, still dealing with issues. Like you said, he's, over the last several years, has not really played more than 70 games consistently. And that's tough to build out of that when it happens so often.
Yeah, and it's one thing to miss a chunk of games and then come back and then be healthy for a large chunk of games, but it's kind of been on again, off again. And like you said, it's hard to find that momentum and that consistency when you're into the lineup, out of the lineup. You know, it's just, it's tough. So hoping for the best for him, I guess that's all we can say there. Okay, so let's talk about goaltending a little bit. I'm going to pick on Grubauer just a little bit because why not? That's what everybody does in Kraken Nation, apparently. So the over-under for Philip Grubauer, the German gentleman, I'm putting it at a 9.00 save percentage. Is he going to go over or under?
I have over, but that's predicated on a healthy balance of playing time. And we haven't seen Grubauer play under not Dave Hextall as a Kraken. And I think the way that Dave split hockey, or not hockey, but goalie playing time, didn't ever really seem to have a rhyme or reason unless we were on a winning streak. Then he would only, he would always play who the hot hand was, and the hot hand was whoever played in the game we won before. And for Grubauer, at times, that was our playoff run. He played every single playoff game that we've had, and he did very well. But then you've also seen guys like Martin Jones get a ton of playing time through a winning streak, and then it falters, and then you switch back. So I am hoping Bielsma splits that time either close to a 50-50 split or something like a 60-40 between the two. But if he can really give those guys rest and not overplay them between him and DeCord, I think both of them will have above a 900 save percentage.
Yeah, I love that outlook. And just, you know, they're not overhauling their defensive system, I don't think, a whole lot, but they are going to make some tweaks probably throughout the season, change things here and there. So it will be interesting to see how Grubauer backstops behind Dan Bielsma's setup and his system, the way the defense is going to play, and the way the forwards are going to support the defense and collapse. Tonight we saw 21 block shots, so that's a big factor. Mm-hmm. Rebound control is a factor. I'm optimistic with you on that. I hope it's over 9.00 in the save percentage department. I think it might hover right around there, 9.09, 9.05, 9.1, maybe 8.99. We'll see, but I think right in that zone is okay. I would like to see the Kraken put up a lot more goals, though. That's what I'm mainly concerned about. So the goaltending, I didn't worry about it as much last year. There were some stinkers from Grew and Joey at times last year, but largely they were very good, and the defense was very good on the back end, right?
Yeah. It was a change of scenery, if you will, to have the defense and goaltending be more of the positive last season. Overall, this season may not have really been what any of us wanted, but to have something where we were almost consistently on a nightly and game by game basis saying, if only our goaltending was a little bit better, if only our defense was a little bit more accountable, this could have been great. And it flipped. And it was like, if only we could score more goals, this would have been fine. Losing 1-0, 2-1 hurts when you're not putting up shots. So I think you're right. I think if we can put the pucks in net offensively, I think our defense and our goaltending has a lot of momentum from last season to carry over.
Yeah, and maybe, you know, we can continue the theme of not allowing goals in the first 2 minutes of the game. That would go a long ways too. So
or
be
the
ready
second
to
period.
Play. Yeah, right.
The first 30 seconds of the second period. I'd love to eliminate that from all of our history.
All the typical Kraken goals, right? Like the response goals, unless we're scoring them, of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, Shane Wright. I think he will make the opening night roster and stick with the big club. We'll see. He may, you know, sit a couple games here and there as they rotate guys through, but largely I would expect him to be a regular contributor. But I don't think that he's going to score a huge amount of goals. I think a good line to set for him is 15. Do you think he's going to go over that or under that?
I think he goes over, but again, kind of like my Beniers over, I don't think he's going over by much. Like I think 20 goals for him, I think is going to be a little bit of a reach because to your point, he's going to play. I think he's going to make the roster and I think he's going to get a good deal of playing time. But I see some form of TOI share that we've done and we've seen with like Sprong, Donato, Geeky, kind of splitting that in our early phase of the franchise. Last year with Yamamoto, Belmar and other guys sharing ice time as they are the scratches. I think Shane's going to probably be your first up in that group to get the ice time, but I think he's going to cycle out a little bit just because he's played long seasons. He's played at multiple levels and an international tournament in the same season before, but he's not played an NHL level full season before. So I would be shocked if he plays more than 70 games this season, just with scheduled scratches or just rotation. But I think it's very easy, the way that he can find the net. And if he gets into a groove, I think 15 goals is easily attainable.
Well, and especially if he's going to be contributing on the power play, which, you know, great spot for him. And it looks like that has been the case, at least in the preseason, a little bit here and there. So I'm optimistic. I think he's going to go over 15 goals, similar to you. I don't think it's going to be much more than 20, if 20. If he does go over 20, that would just blow away my expectations. Yeah. And you might just have a Kraken team that is exceeding expectations overall, if that's the case.
Yeah.
Rising tide lifts all boats type of deal there. So we'll see what happens. Let's talk about Jared McCann next. Largely the leader for this team in a lot of categories. He's struggled with, you know, some head injuries and things like that through the last couple of years, but he's been dependable. He's been a sniper. 33 goals is the line I set for him for this season. You think he's going to go over that or under?
I think he goes under, but for a positive reason. I think he goes under because we're not going to rely on him to be our leading scorer as much. And I think he goes under because Shane Wright goes over. Maddie goes over. We see more goals out of Eberle. We see more goals out of Yanni Gourde. I think the consistency of scoring across all four lines, I think, is going to return back to the depth of what has made Kraken hockey successful when it is. But what that means is we won't have a 40-goal scorer. We won't have a 100-point skater. We probably won't even have an 80-point skater. But we're going to have a ton of guys get to a 20-point level. We're going to have a ton of guys get to a 20-goal level that we saw in that year two with success everywhere on that roster, everybody contributing equally amongst those four lines. I think we're going to see a return to that. At least that's what I hope. But that means that we won't see as much from any one contributor. And that means McCann will go under 33 goals.
And I'm totally okay with that. I prefer a team that is dialed in across all three, all four lines. You know, they've got their legs turning. Everybody's contributing. It feels better to me when you're able to do that, because you inevitably need to do that in the playoffs. Yeah. You can never, like, look what the Oilers just went through. You know, they had to lean heavily on their star players to get them back in that Stanley Cup final. The depth wasn't there as much. And there you have it. So if you can have your depth clicking across all of your lines, and then some of your big stars show up in the moment where they need to, that's going to propel you forward, I think. Let's talk a little bit about some of the additions, some changes to the team culture, some of the changes to the team emphasis areas. Let's go into just the culture, the focus on increasing speed and you know, fast zone entries, things like that. We've got Jessica Campbell in the fold now, coaching and helping out with the power play. So that's awesome to see. I just, you know, kind of what are your thoughts on the team culture and the way they're changing things overall?
I think the situation that the behind the bench and that culture shift that you mentioned, to bring up most of that squad from AHL, from Coachella Valley, who went to back-to-back Calder Cups finals, by the way. So that's a big deal. And that's a group that's clicking and working, and their system works. To bring most of that coaching staff up to fill those empty spots that were available, the anticipation is that they are going to continue that success or continue that scheming to where it's going to work at the next level. So that's the design of that. That's why you promote from within for somebody like Bielsma. That's why you convinced him to take an AHL coaching position in the first place, was, hey, we want you to help build this system. We want you to start it. We love the way you do this. Maybe foresight was back then of being able to say, hey, and there might be an opening eventually back up at the big league bench. And I'm happy he stayed around to do that. I'm so happy to that he's here. I'm glad that they kept Dave Lowry. He was, I think, my favorite assistant coach that we have. Seeing guys like Jay Leach leave, who it seemed like writing was on the wall that he would. McFarlane going as well, opens up spots, but the people we filled them with are going to work within this new scheme that I think is going to be vital for a change in the way the Kraken play that was not there under the previous regime.
Yeah, and something that's really stuck out to me just through the beginning of the preseason and, you know, kind of tuning into some of the coverage for practices, you're seeing this emphasis on constant movement, you know, the quick zone entries. We saw one just the other night where they come up hard the right side really fast, and then they kind of reverse flow back up to the point, over to the other point, and, you know, get a quick hard shot on net, crash the net. So a lot more movement, a lot more attack on the rush, and you've got to be able to carry the puck in. And I think they've got the puck handlers on the back end and the front end now that can do that. So I think that's going to go a long ways. Mm-hmm. But you also have to support your defense coming out of the zone. I think that's something the Kraken have been pretty guilty of in the past, where the forwards aren't supporting the defense and the defense isn't moving the puck well out of their own end and getting caught up and making mistakes. So I think it's good to see the change, the speed. It's a little bit more exciting to watch, hopefully, for fans. But Brandon Montour is going to be a big part of that on the back end. I preferred this contract over the Stevenson contract. We can talk about that a little bit, but let's go into Monty first. Number 62 for your Kraken this season, fresh off his cup win with the Florida Panthers. Just give us your thoughts on this puck-moving defenseman coming over to the Kraken, Rick.
I really, really, really liked the signing. I was not upset about the length or the figure, like you said. Questions could be asked about length and figure for Stevenson, maybe, but Montour, he was arguably the best defender in the free agency class. I don't really think anybody going into free agency had Seattle being his landing spot, just because of how highly coveted he was. Like you said, coming off of a Stanley Cup, like, trophy winning season, like going out of last season, firing your coach, coming into a new system that doesn't really scream the top free agent signing coming here. I love that we were able to, especially considering that length and figure were not really things Ron Francis had ever really done before. Very shocked, very surprised, but I think it is going to be next level hindsight that we're going to look back and say that this might be one of the most important and one of the most fruitful signings of this early phase, first 5-10 years of the Kraken franchise is going to be the Brandon Montour signing.
Yeah, I really feel like he can be a game changer. The other day, Striatic over on X.com, one of the friends of the pod here, pointed out that as far as the captain discussion goes, which we're going to get to in just a second, Montour might be one of those guys where, you know, they don't name him captain, but, you know, 6 months from now or a year from now, people would be like, oh, wow, we really could have or should have named him captain. He can have that big of an impact, and he can really add to the offense, even being a defenseman. I think that's something that we're going to see. He's going to be a huge guy to propel the power play forward and just puck movement in general, which improves your offense. Now let's talk about the Stevenson contract. I know this has been a little bit of a point of contention for a lot of Kraken fans. Nobody really loved this contract, but let's talk about the positives. Stanley Cup winner, fantastic in the faceoff circle. Talk a little bit about kind of the dynamic dimension that Chandler Stevenson can bring to this Kraken roster, Rick.
Yeah, I'm a big advocate for putting a high value on faceoff wins. It's why I loved the Pierre-Édouard Belmar signing going into last year. And even with him not playing more than 50 games or so, whatever he did, and being 38 going into this season, if he's going to make the club with Colorado, he'll be 39, almost 40. You can't diminish the value that you have of, one, winning your own faceoffs, but two, for somebody like PEB, he's helping everyone around him. Like, you would see constantly at practice, he'd be staying late with Shane. He'd be staying late with Maddie and helping them get better at their faceoffs. We saw Maddie Beniers have a slight increase in his faceoff. He still has yet to hit 50% for a season, but he got better. So you need a veteran voice who's consistent at the faceoff circle, to really build everybody else up. And I think that is going to be something huge for Stevenson to be able to provide. And what he does that somebody like Belmar doesn't is he actually can get your point tallies up. He'll score, he'll get some assists, which is the only thing you really didn't see from Belmar was he's not a point tally person. He's kind of like your career Tanev guy. They're not going to get a ton of points, but their value still shows on the ice. Stevenson is going to see that value from the faceoff circle, but also transition into or have points as well. So I think that is key for him. But I don't like 7 years and I don't like the seven some odd that we gave him. We are the Pacific Northwest. It's a little easier to make a point that the Pacific Northwest isn't just up here in the upper left, like you can in baseball or football, where there aren't other teams around us. The Northwest in general, with how heavy Western Canada is and for having the Canucks so close, it's not as much of a, you have to go out into the yonder and redo Lewis and Clark's expedition to get up here. But we are still a new franchise, so sometimes you're going to have to overpay to get the talent that you want. And it might be years from now we look at it and say that was a really bad overspend, but you got to look at what they bring to the table. And I think his faceoffs are going to be the main thing that I'm going to look for from him to see what that value is. Now, saying, hey, he gave us faceoffs, that was a good $7 million every year to spend. It's probably minimizing that a little bit. But that's also trying to be optimistic about it too.
Yeah, so the optimistic side of that, you know, you have to look at the fact that Ron's maybe trying to identify a complementary piece that's going to be, you know, he's going to have his legs for a little while and be alongside there with Matty, Shane, some of the young guys that are going to need people to pass to or receive from to score their goals. So I think Stevenson provides that experience, that steady presence. He's going to help feed possession, win faceoffs like you talked about. So Yeah, I'm not going to pretend like I love the contract. I don't think Ron would even pretend like he loves the contract, but sometimes that's just the cost of doing business, the location, the place that we're in, all of the market dynamics. Sometimes you just have to deal with what is available to you. You know, management probably told him, hey, we need some offensive firepower. We need a goal scorer. If it wasn't going to be Marchessault, which it didn't sound like he wanted to come here, you got to go somebody else. And Stevenson was that guy, and he bought in and wants to be here. So there's also a positive there. He wants to be here. He wants to be part of this culture moving forward, right?
Yeah, and especially coming from a former Vegas Knight, for him to want to be here, it's great because the league loves pushing that rivalry. So to be able to have somebody like that coming from that franchise, and like we talked about with Montour, like Stevenson is a Stanley Cup winning hockey player, and he's a veteran that's going to be able to bring that over here. The year we went to the playoffs in year two, we were stacked with Stanley Cup playoff veterans that had played multiple seasons in the playoffs. We had multiple cup winners there. Mm-hmm. In order to do well at that level, you've got to have guys that have been there before. And that's what he is serving there as well.
And a lot of the addition has to come from within, right? So Shane, Riker, Evans, these guys are going to be figures moving forward. And some of those goals and the totals in the goal scoring department are going to come from Shane Wright as well. So we talked about it earlier, maybe the future arriving just right before our eyes. Shane with a solid preseason. Riker Evans, a really tough defender, maybe kind of underrated in that area. We always talk about his ability to move the puck and his mobility. But Dan Bylsma alluded to this in the preseason as well. Very tough defender and hard on the players he's guarding and hard on the puck and hard into the corners. So Riker, you know, maybe kind of an underrated area of his game.
Yes, I really like Riker Evans. I have wanted him at the NHL level since probably before he was ready to be at the NHL level, but I've bought in on him. And I think his career trajectory is going up and will continue to climb at a perfect time for somebody like a Jamie Oleksiak, who might, at the end of his current contract, may re-sign. We may not want to re-sign. That'll be a question in the air next season, year after. I don't exactly know when his is up, but it's up sooner than Dunn, Larson, some of those top-line guys. But we could see Riker really find his groove, really reach that next level right at that time where it's like, cool, you're going to slide in from being that sixth, the bottom third pairing or a seventh defender to get some scratches up into like a second line defense, which is probably on this roster where he fits in trajectory of his career perfectly. But I like it. He has shown offensive capabilities at the junior level and in the AHL. He scored a couple goals last year with some time. So I'm really excited to see what he can do, knowing that he's going to be a featured piece on the defense rather than bringing him up, sitting him a bunch, but he gets to practice with the big boys. But to have him actually get time and to really see some coaching and NHL effort put in to give him time, I think is going to be huge for him. He's part of that young nucleus and that young core that we can have that can lead us through several years of success.
Yeah, you've got William Borgen coming up next year as a UFA. Riker's going to be a restricted free agent that same summer. Alexiak goes out to the next summer, 26-27. He's unrestricted. So you have a little bit of staggered room and time to deal with things there. But William Borgen would be kind of the next one, and then Alexiak after that. So I kind of like what you're thinking there. Riker's going to be ready to go. You have to make some decisions on Borgen and Alexiak as you get into the back end of their contracts, because you don't want to wait till it expires and then move them if you're going to do that. You need to do that ahead of time when their trade value is high and they can contribute during a stretch run for another team if they're headed towards the cup. Or maybe hang on to them if we are, but maybe we're not quite there yet. So we'll see what happens. All right, next up, I wanted to talk about the brand new Kraken Hockey Network, the television deal that's in place, and it's going to be a big benefit for fans across the Pacific Northwest to be able to consume Kraken hockey. Rick, let's hear your take on this new deal for the Kraken.
I think it is a absolute 100% win across the board. Root sports made sense from the onset initially, but it does not anymore. And it does not look like that network is going to do well going forward. So somebody had to jump ship. They had to be the first to do it. The Kraken ended up doing that. Since the Kraken have announced the TV deal on their own production, Root has also lost the Portland Trailblazers, who they had for the Pacific Northwest, which means Root doesn't have any flagship team through the winter months of broadcasting. That's going to be absolutely devastating for that network. And they might even lose their own entity. The Mariners own Root, and they might have to just dissolve because they're going to have really no flagship broadcasting for several months. So the Kraken made the right choice to leave. Huge is retaining all of their studio and TV play-by-play analysts. They retained all of their personalities. The only exception is Nick Olchek, but he left for something else, and it's going to be excellent. He's going to help usher in hockey in Utah. Like, that's a great move for him. And without it's always been that great dynamic of having Edzo and Nick together, but not being on the same crew as his own dad is going to let him flourish probably even more than he was already. But being able to keep somebody like Piper Shaw, keeping Allison Lucan, bringing in Ian Furness, who's locally been great. And he was huge on hockey coverage leading up to the official gaining of the franchise when we started putting season ticket deposits down. Yep. Furness was always there. I remember specifically on that day when deposits started going before we officially had it, but we knew we were all going to get it, the franchise. He recorded what could be a Stanley Cup final for what the team would be. And it was really, really cool. He took players that were available. I remember specifically, it was right after Vegas got theirs. And so James Neal was the traveling expansion piece.
The real deal, James Neal.
Yeah, every expansion wanted him. And he did it with Vegas, got moved around. But he had James Neal getting picked as a Seattle franchise because that's who you needed as a veteran presence. We found veteran presence elsewhere, but on his hypothetical broadcast, that's the one name I remember him talking about. But it was so cool to hear this because it was the Seattle team. And that was Ian Furness that did that. So bringing him in is huge. Keeping the broadcast booth with JT, Edzo, and John all back together. For me personally, it's the Amazon Prime aspect of it. As a cord cutter and not having like regular cable and not having the digitalized antenna, Amazon Prime for streaming for everything that's not nationally broadcast is the huge part to me. But having a local free broadcast of 55 plus games is huge. And it is what everyone in the area was asking for. How do we make hockey more accessible and easier to get to watch? And so the Kraken said, well, why don't we just put it on our free broadcast station? And I think that's huge. Now, Kong is not good for streaming, but that's why you brought Amazon in. You literally covered every single base you could ever want out of this deal. And it is, like I said, a win across every facet of this deal.
I just love that any fan in the region that has an antenna and a, you know, digital converter, whatever you need, can consume a lot, if not almost all of the games for free. I think that's big because in a world where things are very expensive, it's good to provide more viewership for the fans. And I think the Kraken knocked it out of the park with this deal.
Yeah,
I understand that the logistical challenges coming in, you know, as an expansion team, trying to build an arena, trying to, you know, there was still putting concrete down opening day back in 2021. So for them to try to launch their own television station and their own streaming platform and their own broadcasts and get, you know, the talent, it would have been a huge logistical challenge and hurdle for them. They've even talked about this in the front office. And like you said, at the time, Root Sports made the most sense. Things change. It didn't make the most sense now, and they move forward. I think they made the right decision, and I'm really looking forward to it. Like you said, Amazon Prime, KJR, let's not leave out the radio side. Always great to listen. I love turning the radio on sometimes when I'm walking around the house doing chores or even outside mowing the lawn or something like that, and I can still listen to the games. Everett Fitzhugh, Al Kaniski, they do a great job over there. Mike Benton, shout out, running everything at Studio Central. So we are so lucky as Kraken fans to have all the talent that we do within the broadcast on the TV side, the radio side. We're also going to get 10 national broadcasts on ESPN or NBC. Yeah. So can't wait for it. And it's amazing for Kraken fans, I think, at large to have more access to these broadcasts and be able to take in more professional hockey. The season starts October 8th. Rick, we're going to do a few more predictions here, and then we're going to wrap up for this episode. Let's talk Pacific Division real quick. I want to hear who are going to be your top three, 1, 2, 3 in the Pacific Division at the end of the season.
Pacific Division, 1 and 2 is a coin flip. So heads, it's Vegas Golden Knights, tails, it's the Edmonton Oilers. And I think that's going to be how it is for a few years now still. It's been that way the last couple years, but I think those two are locks. I'd probably lean towards Vegas. I think they have a little bit better of a full offensive roster, like I have alluded to in the past for the Oilers. I think I've alluded either here or the previous recording when we were doing the live post game of the game. But Edmonton relies a little bit too much on Draisaitl and McDavid. It helps and it works most of the time, but you can't rely on two guys on a 23-man hockey roster. And I think Vegas has a little bit more of a full roster to do that. They've won a Stanley Cup more recently. So I think it goes Vegas, Edmonton, and then I think Seattle's in the running for third. And that's going to be a very crowded room between Seattle, Los Angeles, and Calgary, and Vancouver.
Yeah, Vancouver's right in there. And Vancouver, you know, they won the division last year, but I do think a lot of people expect them to take a little bit of a step backwards. They lost quite a few key pieces. Thatcher Demko, questions there with goaltending. So I love it. I think I'll give my three real quick. I think I'm just going to go. I feel like Edmonton's going to win the division. It's probably going to be Vegas number two. And then right there in three, I'm kind of with you. It's going to be maybe a log jam. between Vancouver, Seattle, maybe Calgary makes some noise. But I think it's going to be Vancouver. So those are my top three. And I hope Seattle makes me wrong. I hope they can jump into that third spot. And I think in general, it's going to be a great race in the Pacific. I do like to see the improvement happening in San Jose. You know, grew up a Sharks fan, so can't wait to see what happens there. Anaheim could be a question mark. You know, maybe they surprise this year and take a big leap forward, but I didn't really love what I saw out of Anaheim. Okay, last one of the night, and we've been waiting for this one. Who is your next Seattle Kraken captain?
Before Vince Dunn shocked Kraken Twitter with the four cat emojis and kind of jumped the gun and told us all that Larson was getting his extension, I probably would have said, I was a big Yanni Gourde for captain guy, but I probably would have said Jared McCann. With Larson getting a new deal and an extension, I think it's Larson. That's my pick.
I am 100% with you. I think it's going to be Larson. I've kind of had him, I know Jim over at Kraken Fancast, kind of been his dark horse for a long time. We've talked a lot in the background. Just feels like a good pick. And you could treat it as, you know, maybe a little bit of a bridge. Those three, four, that extension now, like you said, and maybe eventually like Maddie or Shane, one of the young guys will take that torch and run with it when the time comes. We'll see what happens. But yeah, Larson. And I think number two there for me would be Eberle as captain. But and Monty is kind of that wild card pick, which, you know, I don't think he's been here long enough, so that probably won't happen. But definitely leader. He's got the experience, Stanley Cup winner just this last summer. So we'll see. But yeah, Larson, I think, is going to be the next.
I think it's all going to work. He's the Iron Man of the franchise. I know he missed one game, but it was for the birth of a child. So I don't count that as missing a game. Like, that's a very valid reason. And it he should still have, he's played every game, because you're going to miss for that. And no one faults him for that. It was an injury. It was a perfectly valid reason to not play a hockey game that night. He's played every game in my book. Like, that's a huge, huge, huge thing. He's the veteran leadership on that defensive line. Like, love it.
Absolutely. Can't wait for this season to go down. Like I said before, Tuesday, October 8th, 1:30 p.m., a day game. Things kick off at Climate Pledge Arena against the St. Louis Blues. Rick, thank you so much for being here tonight. Can't wait to have you on throughout the season. Any final thoughts here as we wrap up episode one of season four?
Oh, man. This is going to be a fun ride. Like, it's an unprecedented spot to be in for Kraken hockey, because we just had it's the first season with a new coach. A new hired coach, because obviously season one was a new coach with Dave Haxtell, but this is the first time the franchise has changed gears. And I think we're going to see within that first 10 games or so what this is going to look like for us this season. And I am fully optimistic that a Dan Bielsma led Kraken team is going to be leagues better than what we saw last year.
So lots to look forward to, a lot of positivity, and a lot of, solid things happening in the Kraken future. Young players now cracking into the lineup, and I think it's going to be a great season overall. I'm looking forward to it. Make sure you check out today's episode over on your podcast app and all the other episodes we're going to bring to you here at Sasquatch NHL. And like I said, Rick's going to be a little bit more of a part of things here throughout the future. So thanks again, Rick, for being here tonight, and looking forward to it in the future. Morning Cup of Kraken, try to publish those throughout the season as well. And of course, right here on YouTube, live streams throughout the season. So that's going to do it for episode one, season four. Thank you so much, everybody, for tuning in. We'll talk to you again real soon right here at Sasquatch NHL. Have a great night.